10 seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Hello and welcome back, folks, to week 4 of the Collegiate Star League season. My name is Chaz. I am joined by Gorgon the Wonder Cow. Gorgon, how you doing, my man?
I am doing well. It's nice to be here for the CSL again.
It's good to hear. Good to hear. We are coming off of a 2-0 victory for the side of Cornell on the East Coast, pulling that out over Carnegie Mellon University. But here, West Coast action, kind of. We have Team Texas from UT Austin and University of Utah from the University of Utah. How are you feeling, Gorgon?
It's okay. We had a little bit of trouble with getting me into the lobby, and so I'm a little frazzled. But other than that, I'm professional. I'll take care of it.
We're alive, Gorgon. We made it.
Yeah, and already we're seeing some bands come through. Ricky and Drow band. The Ricky is an interesting one because I don't feel like we see very much Ricky at this level play anymore.
Yeah, we really don't. It's kind of fallen off completely. I know for the two games earlier today, Ricky went untouched, unbanned and unpicked. What we did see was a whole lot of Slardar. I'm not sure if that's just the East Coast thing, but I feel like that hero is very good.
I've been seeing a lot of Slardar in my pubs, if that's any indicator. But, you know, he's a hero that provides you with a lot of control. He can fit a lot of lanes. It ends up working very well. Lion's another very popular hero here. Some other heroes that have been pretty popular are like Juggernaut. We've even been seeing an uptick on Death Prophet to some degree.
Very true, and Warlock too. Warlock, for whatever reason, has made this huge insurgence. I know you've been keeping probably up to date with the oddities of the meta, but for whatever reason, Warlock has just surged into the public eye.
Yeah, so Warlock's a really good hero for a pick and push style gameplay, which has been increasingly popular. He's also a hero that we saw uptick a little bit in professional Dota just before the international. We saw a couple of teams drafting him early because they could run him both mid and as a support. And then we've seen Wings play quite a bit of Warlock immediately after the international to a point that they were maybe a little bit ahead of this curve, although it's difficult to say that for sure because they play so many heroes. It's hard to tell if they're ahead of a meta curve or just playing their own meta and other teams are copying them. But Warlock, very popular in China right now. And he's starting to leech into pubs for similar reasons. He's also got one of the highest win rates in pubs, especially at higher levels of MMR.
Really? That is interesting. Warlock is such an odd hero to me. He's been out of the meta, or I just like public eye, for so long. It's great to see him insurge back. And speaking of insurgents, Axe has made such a huge presence in this meta. Me and Llama were talking about it, but he does fill a pretty similar role to the Slardar, except Axe has much better fallback into the jungle.
5 seconds remaining.
Yeah, what Axe doesn't provide that the Slardar does provide is that sort of that control and vision advantage. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't synergize alongside physical damage dealers as well as a Slardar for the obvious reason of the amp damage. But if you're going to pull out a hero like Warlock, who's going to be doing a lot of his damage with Fatal Bonds, you're going to be pulling out, I assume, some other magic damage dealers as well, then an Axe actually fits your meta far better. For one thing, he does fall into the jungle very successfully, as you mentioned. But the other thing is that he tanks damage a lot better than Slardar. So he can be out front and actually taking the brunt of damage. So if you do have these lighter weight magic damage dealers on your team, they aren't going to have to take as much of that aggression.
And not to mention, the Chaotic Offering is great setup or follow-up, depending on the situation, for that Berserker Skull. So I definitely like the two in conjunction.
Radiant Team Band.
Yeah. And not just the Chaotic Offering, Upheaval by itself.
Oh, very true.
It's a tremendous spell.
You forget he has that spell. It's so undervalued.
Dire Team's.
So Warlock was for a long time one of my top played heroes, and I haven't actually played him in a couple for a couple of patches. Mm-hmm. But like, I've played a lot of Warlock, and I sit somewhere above a 60% win rate at a similar play level to what a lot of the CSL teams, like the mid-ranked CSL teams, or privileged players that play it, like my MMR bracket, or at least the bracket I was in during that time. I would be really surprised if we don't see a couple of early levels of Upheaval with a Lifestealer and an Axe. It is a tremendously undervalued spell. And a big mechanical thing with that spell that many people don't realize is that the slow channels, even if those units aren't in the circle of upheaval. Mm-hmm. So if Axe can grab a hero with Berserker's Call and drag that hero into an upheaval that's already been channeled, that hero can't get away. If it's already been channeled close to the maximum distance, you'll have plenty of time to beat him up.
And another great compliment to the slows from that upheaval is Lifestealer. Lifestealer, just, he's known to be kited around like no one else, right? It's just, that's his thing. So I really do like the draft that Texas has put together, and the color schemes matching, you know, that's a big thing for me. So it's, I'm liking the draft out of Texas so far, but Razor. Razor is another great pick. He's also kind of making an insurgence into this meta.
Yeah.
It's good to see him, and I think this is a strong pickup from Utah.
I think Razor is probably about the best pick that they could have grabbed here. Not only is he really, really good against Razor, but he's also really, really good about with slows that hold, because he can just throw a static link on somebody even while he's being slowed, and they have to run away from him before they can really engage him in a lot of situations, right? So you throw a big upheaval on him, you throw a big open wounds on him, it doesn't really matter. If he gets that static link out before Berserker's Call comes in, you probably want to bail on that gank attempt anyway, unless you can blow him up.
Very true, and then bringing in the Vengeful Spirit here, this is just a lot of team fight presence coming out from Team Sectus here, and as you were mentioning with the Razor, he does fare fairly well into situations like that, bearing in mind he needs to land the Static Link first. However, the Venge here does provide a good bit of damage that I would argue Texas is kind of missing.
Yeah, this would be... It looks like this is going to be a roaming Murana. Mm-hmm. If it's not a roaming Murana, this would be a very good game. I don't know. I'm torn here because they University of Utah would really, really, really benefit from armor, from mass armor. Mm-hmm. Because everything on Team Texas right now, despite the fact that I thought that they would go for some magical damage, pretty much everything is physical except... Fatal Bonds, and Magic Missile, right? Pretty much everything else is either physical or pure. Even the Chaotic Offering is going to be doing a lot of physical damage from the Golem. And despite the fact that the Axe is in play, making the Shallow Grave not nearly as useful, the armor from Weave could be really valuable here. And so the Axe was a really good pick for if only for that reason and no other reason. Timbersaw is a good picker because he is mobile. There are not a lot of stuns to cancel Timbersaw's mobility. He kites the Lifestealer and the Axe fairly well, and he deals with that physical damage really well.
Last range, or last batch of bans is coming out right now. Both teams looking for, it looks like, a core for the side of Utah, and then
it does.
A mid for the side of Texas. Remaining. I'm kind of thinking TA for Texas, but as you were mentioning, they're pretty heavy physical right now, so that would just lend itself to an armor strategy.
Yeah, well, there isn't a lot of armor coming around. I mean, I guess you could run an Assault Cuirass on the Razor, but that's not a very common build, and I don't think that is going to be your optimal strategy if you're Utah. So everybody could pick up some armor items, but I'm not seeing a mass armor strategy coming out of them. I can't think of a hero that they could pick up that would bolster whole team and still allow them to pick up a core. A Dragonite here would help them with their push. It would give them a very high armor hero. It would give them a good reliable stun and the negation of that damage. For University of Utah, I think Dragonite would be a pretty good pick as cores go, but that only helps the one hero. It doesn't end up helping.
It is a core Murana.
Okay, so that's a mid Murana farming carry Razor is what it looks like.
Yep.
I don't think Elder Titan is the pick if you are... I don't think he's the pick if you're going to go for a support here. He doesn't help you with any of these problems that we were talking about. He doesn't stop kiting. He does, the stomp gives you a big setup potential. If it syncs well with the static link, it syncs well with Sacred Arrow. But there's not a setup for the stomp. You don't have a fallback hard carry that goes late super well if the early game doesn't go well. So basically University of Utah have to ride a momentum train here, I think. And the Elder Titan kind of feeds into that.
I am with you. I was more on board with the roaming Murana. I thought that would be pretty impactful here for the side of Utah. But regardless, they'll be farming it up, and Elder Titan is by no means a weak hero or an underpowered hero, and as you were mentioning, Stomp does lend itself well to a couple of teamfight abilities and setups for the side of Utah, but this is a pretty tall task for a Razor and Timbersaw primarily to deal with, because Lifestealer is going to have his way with the Marana.
Yeah, it would be especially difficult if Team Texas gets himself a mid that goes late really well, or a mid that scales very well. Even like an Alchemist here would end up being a pretty good pick. You've got the Unstable Concoction, which is non-disjointable, so that's great into the Marana. It's good into the Timbersaw. The negative armor onto Utah from the Acid Spray would work well with every single member of Team Texas's draft. And then in addition, he scales for some global presence by the 20-minute mark if you don't shut him down. And since you know the Marana is not going to be roaming, he's not going to be in nearly as much trouble as he would have been with a different composition out of Utah. Oh, Alchemist is banned. I'm talking a long time about the Alchemist.
I didn't catch it either. I wasn't just letting you ramble there, Gorgon.
Okay.
I was on board, and I wasn't even looking. You sold me. That was quite the pitch.
That would be the pick, right? If he were still available. Other picks that they could really go with here. Windranger is an okay pick. She's high physical damage. She gives you a little bit of control. She has a non-disjointable stun to deal with the Marana, similar to what I was talking about for the Alchemist. The one big problem with the Windranger is she's all single target damage, and so is the Lifestealer. So Axe is really the only hero that you have that can do multiple target damage. So in big team fights, University of Utah could actually come out ahead, which is really what they want to be able to do. They want to be able to take team fights around that 8 to 14 minute mark.
Well, we are all loaded in. Obligatory pause. Name of the game here. In the meantime, run us down the Utah squad for us, Gorgon.
All right, well, on Utah, we are going to have Kyle sneaking about on that Lifestealer. Purify is throwing out the waves with Vengeful Spirit. Maximo's taking Axe for a spin. We have Cross Angel 19 playing with a little help from his friend on Warlock. And our Windranger is disconnected, so I don't know the person's name.
That is Arthur.
Arthur. Yes. Oh, he is the one that is spawning in. It kind of looks like an anti-mage almost there. Anyway, Arthur is coming in on the Windranger.
And that was the side of Texas, so I'll break down the side of Utah. On the Lion is Pops.
I got no excuses for that.
Utah, I get it. It's cool. Simba is on the Marana, Happy on the Razor, teleporting out on the Elder Titan. Now plays a good ward, is Sylar. And finally, wrapping it out on the Timbersaw is X5.
All right, so our dire side here, Texas, is actually going to be smoking up and looking for a kill. This is the wrong way to go if you're smoking looking for a kill. This is something that I see a lot of teams in CSL do, and it very rarely ever works. You pretty much, if you're going, are they going to roam out this way now? No matter how you end up trying to smoke up for an early rotation, you have to avoid going downstairs and then upstairs, right? So you can't do it through the river. You either have to come out here and around like this. This is the least likely staircase for you to be caught, or you have to come down around this way. Doing it the way they did, they got a ward up, but it's up on their own side. They could have put that down anyway. Or they didn't even get a ward up. I'm sorry, man, I am all over the place.
They
today.
Got a ward on the bot rune. That's not one of the most beneficial wards for a smoke.
Right. Certainly. I mean, I think they were hoping to see somebody in the river, but like the odds of that are pretty slim, unless your opponents are really cocky.
That being said, they did get, in my mind, a pretty good ward up in this jungle ward, which will keep the Axe relatively safe as he farms. Because we saw earlier in the Cornell Carnegie Mellon games, the farming Axe does wonders when it has time to work. If this Axe gets invaded, as he's doing now, by this Elder Titan, his jungle is going to be suffering from it, and it will get blocked up here. I'm not sure if they saw it. I'm sure he did.
Yeah, I'm sure he saw that come in. Whether or not he realizes that it's a block or not is up in the air. I don't think he does realize, but It doesn't really matter. He's not going to be given a lot of space here, it looks like. Even with the vision, there's not a lot that he can do. And since he opened Iron Talon, he'll probably end up having to fall into this offlane jungle. Also, they don't have a safe laner at all with this Axe trying to get an early level 2 in the jungle. Like, presumably Axe is going to rotate in that safe lane and farm up, as you had mentioned. But, like, with the Razor there to static Link, Axe is not able to go in and contest. And they can't give Razor a free lane.
Right. Razor's, given free reign, are just mid-game animals. You can't kill him. It's either the mech or the Dragonlance or both. And he's just unkillable.
Yeah, and Sylar even feels comfortable coming down into the bottom lane because the Razor is being left completely alone. Axe looks like he's going to try to get up at least level 3 before going to contest that Razor, but there's nothing that he can do on his own.
Interesting to see the aggressive tri-lane here coming out from UT. We don't see this too often in CSL. It does take a good bit of communication, and especially if you have an unstable offlaner. Axe doesn't really fall into that category, but
here we go. The Warlock will rotate up top. I think that aggressive tri-lane was, I think that it was a little pie in the sky, to be honest. There's not a very vulnerable hero anywhere on the UOU squad, right? The static Link is there to protect if the Razor went safe lane. The Mirana has Leap to protect if she had gone safe lane. It ends up, Sylar, as I say this, gets a little overzealous. Oh, okay, here we go. Yeah. Kyle taking the return damage, but it should break up here.
It was not too dangerous of a position, either for the Elder Titan or the Lifestealer. I mean, you see the stomp come out, you rage, and that's pretty much the end of that story. So. Razor, though, is having the time of his life.
So the Warlock is actually just trying to leech this lane. He's not contesting the Razor. He's not opening the lane up for the Axe. Axe is continuing to jungle. So now you've got a pseudo one position Razor who is really not able to contest, pseudo one position Warlock is really not able to contest the Razor, but on the plus side, the Razor is very, very, very unlikely to kill him with the healing power of the Shadow Word. So at least he can get experience here. An early six on a Warlock could mean a good mid-game jolt for Texas, and at least they got that going for them potentially.
Very true, and it's the power of levels really can't be understated, especially on a hero such as Warlock. They're relying on him for a good chunk of their teamfight control, and without Chaotic Offering, that's really not an option. So, it's not the ideal situation by any means, right? They're missing out on a good chunk of gold just due to this presence of the Razor, but the experience is, I think, a nice consolation prize.
I don't love the way that this Warlock is building. He's maxing Fatal Bonds. What that implies, for a max Fatal Bonds build to really do the work that you need done in this game, it implies that you're going to be doing very regular 4 or 5 hero fights, where your opponents are bringing pretty much their whole team to the table, starting very early. And I don't know that that's... Okay, this
Windrander's in actually a heap of trouble here. Went up the cliff and just walked into her own death thanks to the stomp from the Elder Titan. They're going to be in pursuit, but I don't imagine much more is going to come of this unless Simba gets spun on multiple times. Now she'll just walk away. First blood, going the way of Utah.
Yeah. The Axe coming down, I think, made the Windranger feel overconfident. She is a pretty squishy hero. One good stun, one good stomp, and that hero's pretty much dead. But at least she gets a free lane now, as both those, both the opposition heroes that killed her are forced back into the fountain, so she will be able to catch up, and she is way out ahead in terms of last hits in her lane, or at least she will be by the time the Mirana gets back.
Kill on the lion in the meantime. Looks like it was a simple magic missile into Lifestealer's insane damage, but regardless, that's a dead lion. And
you need to be very careful if you are a support in this lane, because in theory you really shouldn't be killable, right? Like you should be able to sit behind the safety of your wave, but if you get even a little bit out of position, that combo is going to wreck you, because your only defensive ability is to stun your opponent, and Lifestealer has rage. So The lion does need to be very, very careful and should probably honestly spend most of his time stacking and pulling.
Oh no, Elder Titan's in a vulnerable spot. Just pops rage and can completely ignore the stomp. He's just gonna die here. Timbersaw getting return damage, but it's not enough. The damage is done. That's a dead Elder Titan. More gold going the way of UT in this bot lane.
Yeah, and that Elder Titan died the exact same way that the lion did, right? And the exact same thing that I was saying about the lion is applicable to that Elder Titan. He had no business being where he was being. Once again, one stun, and he's very likely to just die. The Timbersaw is a traditional off-lane hero. He can handle a one-on-one matchup against a Lifestealer. He can handle even a one-on-two matchup against Lifestealer and Vengeful Spirit as long as he plays fairly careful. And his landing
chaotic offering is actually dropping a top lane on top of the Razor. Call and Dunk will finish up the kill, but a bit overconfident from the Razor there. Probably thought he had a much bigger lead than he did over that Warlock.
Yeah, he may not have expected the Warlock to have six yet, but it's not like that's hidden information.
He's been there the whole time. You've seen him.
Right. And you pull up your little Tilda and look at the scoreboard and say, I wonder if he's got six, right? It's not. There's no aspect of the game that makes that particularly difficult to parse. But, you know, it happens once in a while. We've all been killed without expectation that our opponent had an ability. I like that the Vengeful Spirit is rotated mid to help out this Windranger. She is being caught up to by the Murana. Who also did get a kill. So Murana's actually on top of the network, even though she's a little behind on in terms of last hits.
Aggression onto the bot lane yet again. Actually, barely missed it. Saw the last second. Elder Titan and Razor actually going to pick up a kill here. I assume that was a tried and true stomp combo into some damage. But
yeah, it was Static Link. He got 112 damage stolen during the stomp. Right? That's a great combo. That's what we mentioned in the draft. That Static Link, once you get it, if any stun comes in, that's a tower, you know.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
All right, so I think this Warlock will probably play it safe here. So, the complaint that I had about the Warlock getting the Fatal Bonds, I think, still stands. Right, like right now, with a level 4 Fatal Bonds at level 7, what is he getting out of this level 4 Fatal Bonds that he would not be getting out of, say, a level 2 Fatal Bonds? Because he's not linking more than 4 important units together right now. So and it doesn't do more damage, right? It does 25% damage dealt no matter what level it is. So having 0 levels of upheaval, but it's a waste of levels in my opinion. And he's not going to be able to rotate and really contribute to the control in fights, which I think works out for Utah's advantage here, especially considering they don't have, Texas does not have a lot of reliable control. They are going to try to dive the tier 1 tower bottom, dropping a ward that got seen.
This is a tough duo to take down, though, and especially I think the Razor, Razor's in a position to teleport as well, so if he comes in and any moment, I think this dive is just over for UT, so it looks like they'll play it safe.
Yeah. For the time being, at least, but with the creep cutting, it is making it more difficult for the Timbersaw to last hit.
Axe is still a ways away from that Blink Dagger, about 1,000 gold now, so another kill in the mid lane. I believe it was an arrow. Sacred. Did you catch that one?
Yeah, Sacred Arrow. This is all she wrote. One good arrow on that Windranger's dead. As I had mentioned before, she's just so squishy. She does have a double damage bottled, and she is about to hit level 8. She could teleport.
She's had that bottled for a while. That's about to pop on its own, so.
Yeah, she wants to get somewhere and use something with that. I would like to say she could teleport top and pretty easily get a kill. She is going to teleport top, but without the upheaval, she absolutely needs to land the
shot. She's in a bit of trouble here. Axe, as mentioned, doesn't have the Blink Dagger, so she's just going to run away. Nope. With teleport support coming in, this turned into a decent fight for her. Gets the stun onto the Vengeful Spirit. That's a kill. Static Link onto the Axe as well while running away. Teleport coming in from UT, but oh, there's the Fatal Bonds, Gorgon. It latches onto two. Level 1 could have did that, but Chaotic Offering is dropped in the end. They really want this Razor, and with a Sentry in the mid lane, and the Power Shot as well. He's still ticking down. He's Will he fall? Yes, okay. Will fall in the end. Razor is dead, but Windranger also pays with her own life. Life still on the other side, dueling with the Timbersaw.
Yeah, that's not worth. If you're dropping Warlock's ult and trading one for one, and rotating everybody from the top lane. And the reason I said oh no there is because the Windranger rotated top with that double damage trying to kill the Razor, and Razor just teleported out to support mid at exactly the right time. So kind of a bad communication maybe coming out of Texas. Going into that fight, if you take a fight in the mid lane, people are going to teleport to support right. at this level of play. Mm-hmm. So if your teammate is trying to set up a kill in a different lane, it's a bad time to start a slow fight in the mid lane, right? Because you're probably going to lose that potential kill up in the top lane, for example, which is exactly what happened there. You either need to initiate both at exactly the same time, or you just kind of have to pick one. And since the Windranger had already spent her TP scroll, there was just a really bad time to start an initiation for Texas.
Oh, good shackle shot from the Windrunner. That's just going to delay. Nothing doing there. Lots of aggression in the mid lane thus far. Seems like Mirana's kind of had her way.
Yeah, what I will say is that they are opening a lot of space for this Lifestealer, who got a really good start. I mean, he got two kills right out the bat just because of some mispositioning coming out of UOU. That helps. He's also near the top of the last hits. In fact, if you take jungle creeps out of it, he's at the top of the last hits. And he's getting pretty much on defensive farm. Now, as I say that, never mind, up top.
Yeah, Stomp's gonna miss. Missed time there, so Eldershine will cancel it, but lots of stolen damage from the Razor. Eldershine's gonna chase this down. Actually, will not get the kill. Kill happens bot lane in the meantime, I believe. And lots of damage coming out. Now, Utah's in a bad spot. That's the Elder Titan going down. Razor will almost assuredly fall as well. Mirana needs to get out. She's still going for this kill, and now she's in a world of hurt. Dust popped as well. Razor actually will make it out with his life. Blink, call on a Mirana, and that is almost assuredly her life. And... okay, misses the... gets the kill onto the Windranger. Wow.
That death on the Vengeful Spirit that you thought was bottom lane, mm-hmm. Vengeful Spirit actually teleported top and started tough. Running out from here to try and help, mm-hmm. and just got cut off and died before she ever reached the fight. So that kill happened like right here.
Now, did her negative damage aura affect that fight? I actually didn't catch the Venge dying there.
Probably not. I mean, it did impact the fight, but it was a 12% negation. Okay. And since most of the damage that was really valuable that fight was Starstorm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
yeah. I mean, maybe that axe was very, very close to dead, actually. So that axe probably would have died without it on him. That axe probably would have died if that had not been on, who was it, Mirana? But yeah.
Oh, Blink Dagger on display from the axe with the Lifestealer as well. The Infest Bomb is in full effect. Now Lifestealer, no fears in the world with Rage Pop. Chaotic Offering comes down as well, catches on to two. Timbersaw is here. Axe is just going. He wants the Elder Titan. Gonna try to drag him back into the fight a bit. Needs one more spin. Power Shot will land onto the Timbersaw to pick it up. That's the Elder Titan going down as well. 4-0 in the favor of UT.
Really, really, really good engagement there. And I don't want to harp on this too much, but that was pretty much perfectly executed by Texas. So there's not a lot to say in the negative other than Fatal Bonds wasn't even cast. Imagine how much easier that fight would have been if there was one level of upheaval holding people in place. Just gonna throw that out there.
Razor is now stunned up in open wounds. Gonna get the static link off, but I imagine he will fall. No, the stomp's gonna catch the Windranger.
Power shot in 1 second, though.
Is he gonna actually come back in? He will. Oh, the finger of death. Fatal Bonds was dropped. This could be Razor dead.
If your Razor sitting on 107 health and your Fatal Bonds, and you probably can't take a fight against a Lifestealer anyway, that's a bad position to be charging. I'm not sure why UOU continued to fight that, but yeah.
Just a bit more damage on either the Elder Titan or the Lion probably would have been the death of the Razor. But luckily for UOU, if I'm not Razor, I'm screaming, right? Like, get back. Don't fight that. Right. I don't want to die. But UT decides to back up. Probably didn't catch that the Fatal Bonds would have killed, so... At the end of the day, just giving up one kill, not a huge deal.
Yeah, the Lifesteal was also out of mana, so it would have been a little rough, potentially. If he had turned around, right? Because he wouldn't have had the Rage to keep him alive. But he certainly would have been able to kill the Rage if nothing else. I will also say, like... There was just a Fatal Bonds onto the Mirana and a full wave of creeps. It brought the Mirana down to 970 from 1215, which is not a lot of damage. Like, that's the way that it's basically being utilized. It's basically being utilized as harass because UOU is not grouping up that much, right? So it's basically just linking between creeps and heroes, and the creeps don't have that much health. It's nice against Timbersaw because he has high armor, but otherwise...
It's going to take a lot for you to be approving of these Fatal Bonds, Hugorian.
Yeah, you know, it's just like... God, they could be getting a kill right now if they could slow down this Elder Titan, right? Slow that Elder Titan from a million miles away, and they have it now. They can hit that Elder Titan, like, from here, if this Warlock is sitting, like, there. Because the center, like, the actual edge cast point is there, and that's the center of the circle. That is a huge range spell.
I'm pretty sure it's bigger than that. I'm pretty sure it's like, it's pretty massive. The upheaval is absolutely massive.
It's a 650 radius, right? And then you also have a cast. Oh, here we go.
Infest bomb. Just dead. Yeah, Timbersaw not nearly as tanky as many people make him out to be. He's armor based, not HP based, and he's just dead.
Exactly. That's the thing. Like, he does not survive burst damage very well at all. And an infest bomb is going to be a lot. The other thing. Is that his armor is based on how long a fight goes on, essentially, right? So, if you're able to burst him down, and then you have a high damage-dealing core attacking him, and not creeps, then his armor isn't even very good. Like, he died with two armor.
Elder Titan now in some trouble as well. Taunted up from the axe, and slams it home. That's a free kill. Mirana also spotted up here. I don't know how they have the vision right now. Axe just spot him out. Will not hit the dunk. Razor gets a kill onto the bench in the meantime. Finger of Death as well. Mirana gets stunned up by an arrow. Chaotic Offering does come out. Will it be enough to keep the Windranger alive? Timbersaw going in the back line. Razor should fall here to the Lifesteal if he will. Still in hot pursuit. They're going to change their target to the Timbersaw. Gets stunned up at the last second. Timber Chain canceled. Arrow will fly. Will not hit. Mirana has to leap out. And at the end of the day, that looks like it will be it. Two for two.
Just want to point out. That kill was made possible by upheaval. Good job, Cross Angel 9. That kill was literally made possible by upheaval. And they probably would have gotten one more hero if that upheaval had come out just a hair earlier. But either way, like I'm harking on this a little bit, but UT are executing this perfectly. Like, they're doing exactly what they need to be doing. It's going to be very difficult for UOU to come back into this, especially since the Timbersaw is still short of Bloodstone. So.
Sacred Arrow actually catches out the Lifestealer, who was being chased down by lane creeps. So, free arrow there for the Mirana, and that's an easy kill.
She almost has her Ags up. You're pretty close to the Bloodstone on Timbersaw as well. If they get those two items and are able to take a couple of quick ganks, especially if they're able to get a couple of quick ganks on the Warlock, who bought a Midas, so he's got high net worth, but he doesn't do very much, right? That's basically what a Midas means. And the Windranger, who has very high net worth, but no items. I'm not sure what's going on there. Like, where is... Here we go. They're coming out to her. Okay. Okay. What? Alright, she's working on her eggs, but she doesn't have it yet. So, those two are really juicy targets right now. The Mirana does... She did get her eggs. She should be able to burst one of these two down if she gets a good arrow, especially.
She was farming bot lane at about 400 health right there, and paid the price. Axe grabbed another 2 points on that dunk, so he's doing all right for himself at the top of the net worth.
Yeah, she should be able to do about 1500 damage burst, not including auto attacks. That's enough to kill a Warlock straight up if she lands an arrow. It's enough to kill a Vengeful Spirit straight up if she lands an arrow. It's enough to kill a Windranger with auto attacks if she lands an arrow. So, she's in a position where she can really turn this game and nobody else can. There's still no Bloodstone on the Timbersaw. The Elder Titan is just not going to be able to find good initiations without her. The Lion is way too underfarmed because his game has been going particularly rough. Way too underfarmed to really contribute solo, but the Mirana can actually find ways to turn this game around.
I find it interesting that he's sitting on the Rod of Intelligence rather than something a bit more immediately impactful, such as like Tranks, Windlace. Regardless, stun going out on the Razor here, and they're gonna try to get some damage out. Oh, the Blink Infest Bomb. Chaotic Offering comes out as well. Dusted up is the Razor. He will die instantly. Now, another Dust is pop. I don't think that caught the line. It did not. So that looks like it'll be it for now. They'll just back up. Oh, Mirana actually was in the back, getting a fair bit of damage down. And
actually, she didn't even launch Arrow, and she almost killed Warlock. He's healing up now, but he was down to about 230 health.
Shadow Ward puts UT in a very good place, given that they don't immediately die from Burst.
Yeah, that's the thing, though, right? Like, the contingency there is that they don't immediately die. Yeah, the Axe and the Razor, or excuse me, the Axe and the Life Sword are not in risk of dying to that Burst, but everybody else is. I think Texas are doing the right thing by grouping up heavily here and engaging, and I'd really like to see an upheaval laid right here. Just lay it down from the back line so that if your opponents
this might be some trouble for UT. Venge is gonna die almost immediately. Oh, the Infest Bomb comes out. Tour stunned, Tour dunked, jamming it in. Venge is gonna run into the Spirit. Axe is gonna die from a long range arrow. Looks like Elder Titan will fall. He will. Lifestealer now in the front doing damage. Stun will not latch onto a tree, so that'll looks like it'll be it for now. Just power shots to follow, but UT doesn't have much in the tank to continue this. The Infest Bomb has been expended, so Lifestealer will bail on out, but very cohesive team fighting so far from UT.
Yeah, that's actually that is not as nice of a defense as it at first potentially looks for UOU as well, because they were legitimately at risk of losing a tower there. Mm-hmm. They didn't, which is good, but the hero that they defended at the expense of was Razor, who is somebody that they really desperately need to put some farm on. He's working on Asajj Yasha. He already has the Dragonlance. I'm not positive. I'm not positive stacking HP items is the best direction to go if you're this Razor, because the Lifestealer, of course, benefits from that.
Right. Axe can just chunk you immediately as well. And I guess that goes for anything you build. Actually, Windranger in a heap of trouble here. We'll Windren out A-OK, but after eating an arrow, that's always a dangerous game to play.
Yeah, anytime she eats an arrow, she could die legitimately right off the bat without any response. There's going to be a smoke up from the Dire here running through the jungle, and looking at this Razor who does not have a good defense. Blink up.
Infest Bomb will go out. Moonlight Shadow, but he's taunted up. The dust arrives. And that's a dead Razor.
Yeah. There wasn't a lot of defense there. So the next time we see... The Chaotic Offering is up, by the way. So presumably a High Ground Siege could come here if they don't want to move Roshan. Looks like they might actually want to move Roshan. Yep. It's moving day, buddy. Get on out of here. And the eviction is coming. But what I was going to say is that with the Chaotic Offering, they should be able to get this tower without too much contest. I don't think UOU are in a position really to engage that tower. They might be able to trade, but I don't think that they're really able to defend there. So you move on to High Ground. And in that last fight, Texas probably would not have lost their entire team off the back of that stomp had there been a nice upheaval defending them from the low ground. Right, because then heroes can't chase in to follow up with damage. With both upheaval and the golem available, there's nothing that UOU can do until all of that is expended. Like, they have to spend their stuns on the warlock who's in the back line, which means that they either have to use a stomp to interrupt that channel and not use it for the full team wipe or full team stun, or they have to get the lion somehow that far forward to create the stun. The Sacred Arrow could come out, but that means that you're letting that upheaval run long enough that you see where he is and you can get the angle on the arrow. I don't know. It's a very good insurance policy on a High Ground push, and I'm glad that it has been leveled at this point.
you were talking a bit about the Elder Titan stomp, because he hit a very good one in the defense.
It was really good.
Yeah. 3-man stomp into Earth Splitter, but they just couldn't convert off of that. It looked like a very good opportunity for them to at least.
I mean, they converted two into and a full defense. Very so true. I would say yeah. that's not nothing, but it right. certainly isn't the full team. My point was it probably would have been zero if the yeah. Warlock were behind with an upheaval already running.
Oh,
here we go.
Wink call infest onto two. Dunk will miss, but not needed. Fatal Bonds helping out. That'll pick up a kill for the Warlock. Lifesteal will snag the other. And with the wave actually way down here, this tower is not actually fair game.
Yeah. They're going to rotate mid for this Timber Saw. Really ought to get out of here. Yeah.
Long gone indeed. Looks like they'll just push up mid.
Yeah, or they've not. Got the Aegis now. They also have Warlock ult and a full Fatal Bonds, which is, once again, a really good high ground push ability. Because if you get a Fatal Bonds on two or three heroes, none of them are going to be able to feel safe moving in without jeopardizing its allies, right? Yeah. Like, Warlock is just really good all around at forcing difficult decisions while pushing high ground.
Fatal Bonds alongside an axe as well is one of the dirtiest combos I think I've seen in Dota. Just yeah. massive, massive damage split to everyone. Oh, the Blink's disjoint. Call will also miss from the axe. Well played there from the Morana. Timbersaw actually might be in some trouble here. TP out. Venge is not in range in time. Bit hasty from the Lifestealer, but probably his best chance.
Yeah, they're actually going to chew through top lane, which I don't think is the best use of their Aegis, but it will maximize their net worth advantage, which is now sitting comfortably above 5,000 at 27 minutes. Not the biggest lead in the world, but it is substantial. And then the experience lead really tells you how this game has been going, over 10,000. And taking a look at our hero levels, Axe is level 16, Lion's still looking for his level 2 ult.
Ooh. Finger of Death on, what is it, 160 second cooldown?
Yeah.
140?
And also, at this stage of the game, it's just not doing enough damage to really be. 600 yeah. damage when everybody has... you know, there's an Echo Saber out, there's an Ags out on the Windranger. Like, people have pretty big HP pools at this point.
Looks like they're actually going to go and try to defend this top.
Oh, Axe is done.
Axe just dies thanks to a Sacred Arrow. And now they're going to go onto the Razor. Hexed up immediately from the Lion after the Infest. And Earthquarter will catch on to the Lifesteal. Oh, the Windranger just melts. Venge is just food if she decides to stick around, but the Lifestealer doing a good chunk of damage. That's just Aegis, but I'm not sure he could do much else alone. Warlock is coming after running for a very long time. He's gonna pop dust and Fatal Bonds.
Good cancel.
Yeah. Dominating. We'll cancel on the Chaotic Offering. That would have just hit for Elder Titan. So, yeah. In the end, 3-for-3, but I imagine if Warlock's there in a timely fashion, that fight's way different.
Yeah, Warlock, is he not sitting on it? Yeah, he doesn't have an item spot for a TP. Honestly, probably drop the wand, right, and carry a TP. As you mentioned, that fight, very different. Not only because you have the Fatal Bonds and Chaotic Offering combo, which is extremely potent, but you also have a heal, which would have done a great deal of work for the Windranger. The Axe died too quickly, but for the Windranger, there was some potential option for a salvation.
That is Aegis expended on top of it all. So not only do three heroes fall, but that's also the Aegis. And that's a pretty big deal. What used to be almost an assured tower is kind of thrown out the window. So good engagement yeah. there from UU, and I'm sure they'll take that one very happily. Smiles on their face.
Oh, yeah. That puts them back in this game in a pretty big way. Well, once again, with that Aegis, with everything the Warlock brings to the table, not to mention the frontline potential of an Axe here, they could have gotten through some tier 2s, if not just gone straight for the tier 3 while they had the guaranteed Aegis. And they opted not to. They floated around a lot. They didn't really utilize the advantage that Roshan gives. And I think that was a pretty painful mistake for Texas. In a lot of ways, it put UOU in this game to a degree that they shouldn't be.
It does set them back, right?
Uphill battle,
yeah.
But
it's still an uphill battle, because the Infest Bomb is going to do just as much as it has been. Moonlight Shadow is actually going to be popped, I believe, right on top of this ward. So this is useful intel, and they're going to smoke up and head down.
Yeah, the Sanjin Yasha is done for the Razor, which does help a lot with the burst damage from the Infest Bomb that you were talking about. It doesn't help a lot as the fights kind of linger on, just because of everything that Axe and Lifestealer bring to the table to deal with HP. But it does look like we're going to see a tier 2 for tier 2 trade. That is when you're behind by a little bit less than 5,000 at this stage in the game for UOU, a tier 2 for 2-2 trade is phenomenal. You'll still be behind by about the same amount, but in terms of the total net worth of both teams, you're lowering the percentage substantially of disadvantage.
I almost assuredly they'll all back to defend this because UT still has a very sizable lead on him, and this would be very quick racks. And look at Windranger just going to town on him. We'll get slept up. This could actually be a very big mistake. Let's see. Razor getting probably too much damage. 147 there. They'll just back up.
Yep. Smart move to just back up. They did get a good chunk of that tower, right? About two-thirds, or excuse me, about one-third of the tower, and they still have Chaotic Offering, so they can come back in once that damage expires. But a nice stomp and Static Link combo, once again, deterring this and allowing UOU to kind of pick their pitch. Being able to pick your pitch or pick your moment is arguably the largest advantage of defending high ground. And UT are potentially in a position to strip that advantage away by forcing UOU to make a move. So those stomps are really important. They allow UOU to set the fights up in a favorable position and force UT to pick a moment rather than the other way around.
Well, this is UT's moment to pick, and they go right back to the tier 3 tower. Fest Bomb, prepped and ready. Arrow will land on the bench. That's not an ideal target. Stomp's going to whiff, but good damage down. Moonlight Shadow comes out.
Ooh, that Moonlight Shadow usage was unfortunate.
Probably expected UT to stay a bit longer, and Sentry actually gets dropped, so...
You can tell that they expected UT to stay a bit longer because the Elder Titan moved his spirit up here to stomp instead of stomping at the entrance where he can almost guaranteedly get heroes.
Tower finally does stop go down. Oh, the stomp onto two. This could actually be a pretty big deal. Earth Splitter comes out. It's actually just going to whiff Arrow as well, and UT just runs to the hills.
Chase. There we go. Razor. Oh, okay, Razor made the mistake.
Bench just dies. Chaotic Offering hits three. Fatal Bonds comes out, and this is going to do some work. That is Razor dead. Exposed Rax, but I think that's going to be the only hero kill, and they're just going to move on to the Rax.
Yeah, they'll move on to Rax, and they'll move on to mid. As long as they have the Golems and no Razor, you just don't really have an ability to engage call.
BKB displayed by the Axe, and it looks like Timber's just going to fall here. Oh, the dunk gets out of range. Force Staff will jam it in. Mirana in hot pursuit of the Windranger gets Windrun off, and she's in a heap of trouble now as well. She will die in the end. Buyback coming out from multiple heroes on the side of UOU. Well, they're still in good shape. They have two golems up.
Yeah, and they can stay and fight this if they wanted to. They're just going to let the golems exhaust themselves onto the tower. I think that's fine. They got what they came for. They can fall back, wait for Roshan to respawn, farm up a little bit. They're sitting at a very comfortable advantage when you're Texas, right? There's no AoE clear except the Mirana. And she can only handle one lane at a time, and slowly. There's really nothing else in terms of, like, mass push to deal with multiple lanes of super, so once the mid lane goes down, UT are sitting very pretty. They'll have golems again in 90 seconds, so no reason to force it.
Chaotic Offering. This Warlock pick in general, we've spent a lot of time on it, but it has been very impactful. Yeah. Warlock is very clearly demonstrating his place in the meta. Lifestealer is going to engage onto the Mirana. She's just going to blink out. Moonlight Shadow expended just to get herself out alive. That's really not how you want to be using it, but they're too far behind to really do anything proactive with it.
Yeah, let's mention Purify in that last fight, because Razor got very out of position, and Purify was the one that made that fight work, right? He got that swap off, died immediately, reducing the damage that UOU does for the entire duration of the fight, essentially. Just making it that much more difficult for them to fight into UT, but then also forced the Razor out in a position where it was guaranteed to die. Now, UOU had the option to try and follow up and make it a trade, or to give it up and then give up the Rax, but they really had no option that didn't involve them losing a Rax unless they just somehow won that fight down a Razor. That's very, very unlikely. And all that comes down to a recognition from this Vengeful Spirit that there was an opportunity. So really, really good play out of the Vengeful Spirit. That arguably, that one move by him blew this game open. Like, they had the advantage, but look at the gold chart, right? A 4,500 net worth lead to a 14,000 net worth lead, basically on that one decision from the bench.
Pretty immaculate support play from UT here. A three-man sleep. Actually, I don't think they see it. If they do, they'll let it slide out. And they're all awake now, but this Elder Titan has also been doing a very phenomenal job of keeping UT at bay. A lot of these fights could, as you mentioned, been blown much more open, but
here we
go. Arrow comes out, actually stop, lands on the Lifestealer. Force Staff will get him out. This sleep was phenomenal. Earth Splitter comes out. Swap actually hits onto Venge and her swap target. Axe's arrived though. BKB'd up, and while Razor is doing a substantial amount of damage here, actually eating a bit himself. Windranger lands a two-man stun, not onto the Razor though. She might just die for this. Lifestealer is doing some work on the side as well. Finger of Death comes out. Was it dodged by the Infest?
Double kill. I wasn't watching over there.
I think he may have dodged it. Lifestealer probably in some trouble here now, though. Gonna get out. Axe. Oh, this is very close. Armlet toggles. Phases away. Will he be okay?
It should be fine.
Timbersaw in hot pursuit. And if anyone could do it, it's Timbersaw. But no, they're gonna leave him be. Wow. So
they just. I honestly don't think that they have the damage to hit him while he's toggling. Right, even with the Timbersaw. Like, Timbersaw could keep up with him, but what's he gonna do while he's up there, you know?
I wanna say that Lifestealer dodged the finger by infesting. I'm not 100% on that.
Well, if he did, very nice play.
Yeah, that was...
That was a really good stomp by that Elder Titan. And also,
again,
the Razor,
right?
Moving
yeah.
out this time. What went wrong for them in this bottom lane, right, is there was a decent stomp by the Elder Titan, mm-hmm. and then the Razor came in and started to sap damage, but somebody, I forget who did this, but somebody on the Radiant side started doing damage to multiple targets, so they all woke up from the sleep, and they could retreat together. In this fight over here on the northern side, what ended up happening was the Razor came out, started leeching damage from somebody who was still sleeping, and then targeted down the Warlock while his allies couldn't help, and nobody woke the other targets until the Warlock was too low to really contribute into the fight. And that is absolutely key here for UOU. They absolutely need to make sure that they're all on the same page about who the target is once the sleep comes out. And it should, if the Warlock's ult is up, it should always be the Warlock.
That being said, UOU does have some passive ways of triggering the sleep. If Mirana gets there too early, a passive Starstorm could proc. Say Razor, if he's mid-ult, the Storm, it could wake up a few targets, so... These sleeps have been phenomenal, but U of U just, they've been doing a fairly good job of playing safely around it.
Yeah. I think it was a plasma field that woke plasma them up before, but I'm not positive. Mm-hmm. And that is a misplay. And the Razor then followed up that, even if it wasn't the Razor's misplay there, it was definitely his misplay to chase all the way out till his opponent's high ground advantage, right? Mm-hmm. That was a big, big, big mistake. Unfortunately for UOU, they are recovering from that fairly well after that last fight, like much better than you would expect. They still have a long way to go before they're able to actually push out and start taking objectives, so.
UT is going to pressure the lane without Rax. It's an interesting decision. They have creeps hitting their mid tower now, so they'll probably send someone back to get that right now. But...
Yeah, I'm not sure what they think that they gain out of that, to be entirely honest. It was just the lane that was pushed in. It's close to the Roche pit, so they were just like, yeah, sure.
We'll go there, yeah.
Did they just lose a tower?
I
no, okay, this tower's
so.
Been gone for yeah. a while. Okay. The creeps are pushed up pretty far. I didn't know. Oh, no, remember, that was a tier 2 for tier 2 trade.
Yep.
Just before, yeah. Okay. Either way, they did lose a decent chunk of the vitality of this mid tower, so...
UOU is smoked up. They're actually going to see the Axe. Will that arrow hit? No, it won't. Little do they know this Axe is not alone, and it's going to blink up, and this is turning into a chaotic fight here. I'm not sure this is what UT wants to do. No one's around. They're actually going to pick the Razor off right away. Stomp will come out and hit onto just the Axe. Timbersaw is going to get out of here. A-okay. Is Elder Titan going to be fine? No, the Sentry just dropped from the Warlock. He is dead. Although, U of U is in an odd position. Oh, swap onto the line. He's just dead. Dead to rights. On the side, Axe gets a call onto the Timbersaw. Timbersaw gets slammed home, and Lion's somehow still alive. And
not for long. There we go. Yeah, that was a weird decision to engage.
And Morana's still in a world of hurt here. As the E-Blade will leap away. I don't think they're stopping. Indeed, Warlock will pick that up from way downtown, and now this is a tower. With the creeps pushing in from the bot lane, no backdoor protection. You said it best, Gorgon.
I'm really shocked that GG call didn't come out here. No buybacks for the Morana. They can't prevent this, right? There's a refresher up on the Warlock. They've got four golems with max fatal bonds.
I just want to point out how, like, hardy the base is on Warlock's Chaotic Offering. Like, that's powerful.
You know, he's got a good subwoofer.
There it is, doubling down, dropping the bait twice. Razor's dead, Lion's dead, four are dead. Upheaval just to swag on him. The buyback will be in vain.
That's the second upheaval I've seen all game.
And it's a 4 for nil with a buyback. The call is actually going to... Oh, it will hit, despite the 4 staffing. That will do it for this one. Game 1, going the way of UT. Sooner or later, no GGs have been called just yet. But...
I don't think that UT demonstrated here that they are just a better team than UOU, but I do think that UOU had a very uphill game here with the draft that they decided to move with. Like I said, immediately coming out of the screen, they really had to have very strong mid-game execution to make this work. They had to ride a wave of momentum, and they pretty much did the opposite, right? They got off to a rough start. They didn't control. They gave a Midas up on the Warlock, but then didn't punish him for it. And yeah, then they tried to bounce back after the fact, after they managed to get Ags on Morana. That's the wrong way to do it with a Razor on your team. You really need to ride the wave.
All in all, it was just a series of small missteps from Utah, and there was moments where, like the Razor pursuing too deep in the bot lane before the racks went down initially. Like, it's small, but it was consequential, because those racks did fall, and that set the pace for the rest of the game. And yeah, it wasn't a flawless game from Texas, like you were mentioning, and not necessarily convinced that they're the better team just yet. Well, it's a best of three. We'll see in the next game or two. But all in all, game one will go to Texas, and I'm really impressed by the play of the Axe that game in particular.
Yeah. Really good combo usage by, and especially considering they gave a free lane to this Razor. There just wasn't enough utilization from Utah on that Razor, and there wasn't enough punish onto the Axe. The levels that the Axe gave the Warlock for being able to leech from lane also really, really helped them out. That Warlock getting off to a good early start allowed him to use the Golem very effectively. Well played all around. I think my MVP probably goes to that Vengeful Spirit that we didn't talk about a lot all game, but some of those swaps were, I would say, literally game winning.
Well, that will do it for us for game one. We will be right back after a brief break. See you in a bit.
Ben, Sam, and Ken are on separate journeys to defeat the menacing Vile Dragon. But let's just say luck isn't on their side. If only there was a way for them to find each other and band together. Well, that's why there's Band. It's a mobile app that allows people to come together using common interests. With Band, you can find fellow gamers, chat, schedule gaming sessions, and conduct polls. Stage epic battles with friends while sharing videos and photos along the way. So try Band today. Band. Be together.
Only $14.99.
Don't miss the call. Download Band. Communication made easy.